Hey everybody, welcome back to the universe of Space Engine. Because I love Space Engine. There's a planet over here that has life? I think that's the one we were exploring last time. Where is it? Whoa. Oh yeah, it's way the hell back there. Oh. Anyways, today's episode, we are going to continue stumbling about the universe, exploring, looking for fun things to talk about. Which actually, I have a topic to talk about again this episode. It's kind of a continuation of the last one where I was talking about biology and whatnot. Only instead of being controversial, I'm going to talk about a topic that a lot of people, not a lot, but quite a few people don't exactly understand 100%. Basically, the mechanism of evolution is basically what I'm getting at here. Especially because people in my species videos who complain, maybe not complain, but quote-unquote, show the fallacies in my arguments about evolution, and they link me to creationist websites that prove why I'm wrong. Which, I always read, I always look at every link I'm linked, unless it's obviously porn, in which case I'll, run it through my virus scan first. Anyways, but, this one I was looking at, this person linked me, cause, it's actually my species video, you can probably go read it. This person was talking to me about how evolution can't possibly be real, or for whatever reason, because, oh my goodness, because, you know, life is symmetrical, and, you know, symmetry doesn't randomly evolve, and it's like, well, yeah, okay, that's true, symmetry doesn't randomly happen in biology. It does happen in nature, like, gravity will randomly pull things into spheres, like planets and large asteroids, and, like, symmetry is fairly common in the universe, just because it's a state in which everything's balanced out and even. I'm not getting into that. Point being, it's like, yes, okay, they'll be like, you know, how it's like one argument was, how come humans are symmetrical? Like, you know, did we just, like evolve randomly to be symmetrical? It's like, no, we didn't. It was a very long process to become the way we are today. And it kind of brings me to the idea where it's like, a lot of creationists don't understand that something is complex because it had lots of time to become complex. It didn't just pop into being complex right away. Oh, let's find something interesting. Like the eye argument. It's like, oh, the eye is way too complicated to have evolved. It's like, well, no shit. It's very complicated. It can't just randomly pop in. However, it can evolve because when the eye first evolved, it was a very, very, very simple thing. And it got more complex as, you know, time went on. Like, and the thing with humans, people are like, oh, we're so complicated. It's like, yes, but we haven't been here the entire time. We didn't just pop in, okay? Like, for an example, the earliest known Homo sapien, like what we are, humans, was about 400,000 years ago. So, does that have any life? Nope. Let's go to this hot ocean anyways. So it's like, basically, humans as we are today have only been on Earth for about 400,000 to 600,000 or is it 200 to 400? Whatever, we don't exactly know for sure. It's somewhere between 200 and 6,000. I'm pretty sure it's 400,000. Whatever, anyways. Point being is humans have only been on Earth for a fairly small amount of time. And hominids, the earliest known hominid, which is the genus we are in, the earliest known hominid is only about 2 million years old. So our entire genus has only existed for 2 million years out of the 4.5 billion year existence of our planet. So, yes, we are actually fairly new to the block. We just happen to get a lot done, and we can think about it. But of course, being able to think is both a curse and a gift. Quite the asteroid. So it's like, and yeah, so it's like evolution isn't one creature turning into another magically in one generation. Evolution is mild changes for either good or bad, and it's a mechanism of speciation, which is how you have two populations of the same species start to diverge into two separate species due to environmental factors. For example, if you have two species, this is actually kind of happening a little bit in Canada here, in my province. There's large herds of elk, and there's these two species of elk. Well, there's one's in Alberta and one's in Montana. And they're the same species, but their patterns, like their breeding patterns, are starting to become, like, starting to desync. So it's like the elk here will start to breed a few months earlier, and the elk down there will breed a few months later. And because of this, they become, like, this is a very, it's a very, very initial step. They can still interbreed, but it becomes very less likely for them to breed. So they don't swap genetics. So after a little while, you can get these two populations actually turning into two separate elk species. Just because of that. But anyways, on to the mechanism of evolution itself. Actually, let's kind of go back here and try to find DOS planets with life. The mechanisms of evolution, it basically is a game of dice. I think my best example I can think of is, okay, imagine if buildings, let's say that buildings are our analogy for life, okay? Now, one could look at a skyscraper and say, oh, there's no way that skyscraper is very complex, there's no way it could have just magically happened, or it could, you know, there's no way humans could have just built that, you know, as is, because it's way too complicated. Humans, you know, can't just build something that complicated without knowing how to do it. At this point, we go, wait a minute, what the hell? Floaters? Oh my god. It's a gas giant with, cloud-based life. Sorry to interrupt for a second, but this is what Carl Sagan was talking about this once, is that you can have, life on gas giants, where they basically, you have different species that live in the clouds, and one of them they called for floaters, where they were basically like giant gas-filled whale things that would just float through the air, kind of like giant living hot air balloons. Oh, that's really cool, but these are unicellular. There's no multicellular life. That makes me very sad. And that's what I was saying. So yeah, it's like buildings can't just magically, like we need the ability to make, and there's more floaters there too. Like we needed the knowledge to make the buildings. And if you look at early human buildings, these all have like life on them. But if you look at early human buildings, they were like simple huts that were very simple, and then as human generations progressed, you always had like, you know, the smart ass in the group who figured out a way to improve their housing to make it a little better, and then the rest of people learned, oh, okay, and they passed that information on, and they learned how to make better and better buildings. That's a very simple analogy for what evolution is, and if we can use this in a more of a abstract way, so we can say that buildings are, let's say that buildings are life forms, okay? And humans are buildings' DNA. Like, we act in a building as DNA acts in us. Alright, so now, let's say you have, ooh, let's go there. Let's say you have a bunch of buildings are built in a new location. Okay? So a bunch of these buildings are built, and they're all roughly the same because we know, like, you know, because from the humans who built those buildings came from a place where that design worked well. So they bring them there, and they build new buildings, but there's each architect who goes there has a slightly different idea of what he wants to add to the building. So these ideas are random mutations. So you have a whole bunch of these buildings, and then an earthquake hits, and most of the buildings are destroyed, but not all of them. Some of the buildings have had minor changes or minor additions to them that made them fare a little better. Some of them fared pretty good, some of them fared only a little good. But the thing is, people learned from this and thought, okay, so these buildings that survived better, we're going to rebuild the buildings, but we're going to use their ideas, and we're going to try to improve on them. So then they built more buildings, and then another earthquake hit, and less of the buildings collapsed, but the buildings were still damaged. So people were like, okay, this is pretty cool, but we need to find a way to make it a little better. Multicellular marine life, that's what I'm looking for. So, the architects decide, alright, well, they all have different ideas what they're going to do, so they start adding their little ideas to the new buildings. Some of the architects have ideas that are actually pretty crappy and end up with the buildings not lasting in the next earthquake, where other architects have ideas that actually make them suit better for that environment. Basically, after a few hundred years of this, of, say, constant earthquakes, and people having to think through, all of a sudden, you have buildings that are very much different from the buildings in the other location. Now, I know that buildings aren't life, but this is an example of speciation based on natural selection. The buildings in the first location could not survive in the new location because they weren't built to withstand earthquakes. But because human ideas, which we're going to say like were the building's DNA, which is us, is constantly changing, there were always little additions and little subtractions to the buildings, which made the buildings either fare better or fare worse in these earthquakes. And as a result, people then learned from this, and the ideas that were favorable got used more because they, you know, were safer and they maintained the buildings better. That's kind of how evolution works. It's like you have a bunch of random mutations, and, you know, over generations, generations, and generations, populations that have, you know, little changes that become, like, beneficial, they'll do better and produce more offspring, and then soon their mutation will become, like, the norm. Or, you know, or they may have a mutation that is very successful in one area, but is not successful in another. So you have these two populations that, you know, spread out, and in the one location, they work great, because they have a mutation which is beneficial for them. But in another location, the mutation is not beneficial, and they die out. That is what speciation is. It is not animals turning into another animal randomly, very quickly, through one generation. It's a bunch of rolling the dice until you get beneficial or negative mutations. And the ones that are beneficial last longer, the ones that are not die out. And so you end up with creatures in a location that are best suited for that environment. So the creationist idea that the environments are suited or were like custom made for us is backwards. The environments on Earth are not made for us, we are made for them. Look at these rings. Oh, I screwed up the ring. Oh, wait, no. So it's like, you see a desert lizard. The desert isn't made for the lizard. The lizard is made for the desert. It's like, that's just how it is. It's like, evolution, that's how it works. It's not magic, it's not things randomly. It isn't a human, or isn't a monkey giving birth to a human randomly. That's called magic. It's speciation through competition. Natural selection. In the same way that architectural ideas that are beneficial for a location are in San Francisco, buildings built in San Francisco have very different building codes than buildings built, say, in my city, because we don't get earthquakes here. But in San Francisco, they have potential to get very bad earthquakes. The building codes are different. If an earthquake hit San Francisco, more you'd have a better chance of the buildings that are surviving. If they hit my city, I can guarantee you most of the buildings would not be standing. So it's like, that's using buildings as an example. That's kind of how evolution works. It's just DNA will make random mistakes, random changes through a number of reasons. And yeah, like 90% of mutations don't do anything. I think it's like 9% are harmful and result in either the death of that particular cell or the entire animal itself. What the hell's a carbon star? It's like a brown dwarf? And you have like 1% which are beneficial. So, yeah. Evolution isn't magic. It isn't a conspiracy. It isn't being used to control us, as I was also told. It's just an idea that life can very slowly change and speciate based on environmental factors and random mutations. Ugh. What a gross looking star. That's a very gross looking star. But again, I'm a biologist, so I study this, like, a lot. And I do research on this a lot. I have a bunch of fruit flies right there next to me, which is a long-term experiment. They've been genetically isolated for actually about a year now this month. And I've been subjecting them to different environments. I'm going to switch up their location, but I'm going to try to very slowly increase the oxygen level artificially to see what happens. But anyways, that's not important. What is important is that if you actually research the subject matter it makes a lot more sense than you would think. Like, again, going back to that creationist thing as the example, one of the ones they talked about was, you know, oh, symmetry is impossible to just randomly happen. And they showed, like, an example was a picture of a, like, the motor protein in a, excuse me, they showed the motor protein in a, like, protozoa's, like, a microorganism's flagella, which is, like, its little waggly tail that uses to swim. Like, Euglena have flagella, and sperm have flagella. Anyways, and it shows, like, you know, this motor protein is way too advanced to be, you know, to have, like, just randomly evolved. And it's like, okay, well, what's your rationale behind that? And they say, literally, what they said in their defense was, looking at how the motor protein looks, it is the definite proof of intelligent design. It's like, that's a nice inference. Where's your proof? It's like, I can say that, sure, I can say, I can go out, like, I once found a rock up in the mountains that looked like a phallus. Like, it was really hilarious. It looked exactly like one. Now, I know that it was just a random chance event for that rock to erode to look like that, but I could very easily have said that, oh, this must have been made by someone because it looks so perfect, but I know it wasn't. It was a river rock, literally buried in silt. I was looking for fossils. It was hilarious. But yeah, so, like, again, it's like, you can't just use, like, you can't just use a speculative idea as your answer. You can't just say, it looks like this, therefore it must be. Like, when Erwin Hubble first found out, I forget his first name, but when Hubble first found out, or he saw that galaxies were moving away from each other, he was like, huh, okay, through the Doppler shift, he thought, maybe they used to be from, like, they used to all be a lot closer together. Now, this was an idea based on observation, however, the only information he had, or the only evidence he had, was, why is my computer freezing? One second. Anyways, the only information, or the evidence he had, was the Doppler shift effect of the galaxies moving. So, at that time, he couldn't make the assumption that galaxies were moving away from each other, just based off that alone. He could make a theory and an inference, but he couldn't make, like, a claim that that's what's going on. So he went and he gathered more information, and he got more observations of more galaxies, and more, like, of, like, their motion, whatever, and he actually built up evidence to support his idea. Or actually, he found evidence to support the idea. Like, that's the difference between science and creationism, is in science, you use evidence to make conclusions, whereas in creationism, you make evidence to support your own conclusions beforehand. And that's a very bad way of going about it, because anyone can fabricate information, but if it's not based on solid fact, something's wrong. I want to get really close to the Seer star system. As Carl Sagan once said, science is a self-correcting enterprise. Ideas that are... Holy crap, that is very bright. Ideas that can withstand testing, or that can withstand testing, survive and go on for more scrutinous testing. Ideas that cannot pass simple scrutiny, or cannot be, like, basically, ideas that cannot pass even the simplest form of scrutiny are discarded, whereas ideas that can pass scrutiny then go on to be refined and be subject to more scrutiny until the idea is improved. It's like, no one in science will claim to know 100% absolutes. Everything we know is, again, what Carl Sagan once said, what we know is, this is the best we know so far. So there's no absolutes, it's all about, this is the best we have so far. Like science isn't based on making ideas and then finding evidence to support it. That is a way of gathering and improving science, however, mostly what it is finding evidence and using that evidence to draw conclusions. Now, especially in physics, you can make theories and ways to explain something, and then you can go out and look for the evidence to support it. And if you find the evidence, then great. If you don't find the evidence, then it's not so great, because then you have to discard your idea and rework it until it does fit with the evidence. science can be a real pain because there's been a lot of scientists who have ideas that they fit the bill, they seem to work perfectly. However, once they come up with them against scrutiny, they do not work. If evolution was not real, it would have been discarded a long time ago. However, evolution, time and time again, has passed scrutiny. And people were like, oh, you can't observe evolution. Yes, you can. Antibiotic-resistant bacteria is evolution. The fact you have to get a new flu shot every year, if you so desire, is evolution, because they evolve and change. Literally, babies is an example of evolution, because actually gametes in general, so like human sex cells, or any animal sex cells really, when they form, or actually divide, the chromosomes before, because like each cell has half the number of chromosomes of a normal human cell, and what happens is, a normal cell is divided by mitosis, this is meiosis, where you have the DNA inside of it does a little bit of a transposing, where bits of the DNA shuffle like a deck of cards, and then separate, and then you get half the DNA in each egg cell, for example. So basically, the DNA is shuffled, I'm trying to describe this in a way it doesn't sound like just gibberish. But DNA is shuffled every time a sex cell is produced, and that's one of the mechanisms of evolution, because through this genetic shuffling, you can get a pairing of genes, which then come up with something either really good or really bad. An example is the genes for sickle cell anemia. There's two factors you need to develop sickle cell anemia, but if you have one factor and not the other, then you don't get sickle cell, but you also have a resistance to malaria. Which is why that defect has maintained in our population, just because it's been beneficial for people in malaria locations. So again, through the shuffling of genes, you can have beneficial or negative consequences, but that's one of the mechanisms of evolution. Another mechanism is every time a cell divides, DNA makes mistakes because DNA is not perfect. And then you also get chance events where DNA is damaged and has to be repaired, and it repairs incorrectly. Like with ionizing radiation, if you're around it, then your DNA will get damaged and badly self-repair, and then you can develop cancers because of that. So, yeah, that's evolution. It's very complicated. I hope I made it simple-ish, but I suspect a lot of the part near the end was just gibberish, but hopefully someone understood what I was talking about. A lot of my viewers I've found are actually quite intelligent by reading the comments and all that, so I'm not too concerned about you people not understanding everything, because you're all awesome. I love you all. But it's been 23 minutes, my phone is complaining, I should probably end it here, so thank you all for watching, I hope you enjoyed, and space.